Madam, thank you for giving me this opportunity to say a few words on the Arms Amendment Bill 2019. There are two major changes. Firstly, the definition of new offences. Secondly, enhancement of punishment. Apart from these two, the other change is that a number of firearms can be kept by a person. I want to mention a few international conventions out of which the bill has come out. There is a need to revisit the circumstances for bringing the Arms Act 1959. The bill in the present context is having a root in the United Nations conventions. The illicit proliferation and misuse of firearms is a great curse in these hectic days. By reading this bill, I can understand the circumstances for revisiting the act. Increase in the organized crime by using illicit weapons, a growing number of licenses for arms, and inadequate punishment for the offenses committed for using the weapons have caused this bill to be brought in the House. Madam, in 2001, the most intense effort came into existence through the United Nations. The United Nations Small Arms Conference was held in New York. The primary purpose was to consolidate and coordinate small arms initiatives and develop an agenda for action. The resolving agenda for action contains recommendations for various governments, national, regional, and global. As part of this agenda, the United Nations have taken up the issue of small arms and proliferation of arms in the United Nations Security Council and the United Nations General Assembly. Over these issues, another conference was comprehensively held in the name of the United Nations Conference on Illicit Trade and Light Weapons a year back, which resulted in an international program of action on illicit arms. It was decided in the conference to have a clear and comprehensive set of laws, regulations, and administrative procedures that covers all aspects of manufacture, transport, storage, and disposal of arms. These are the prerequisites for an effective national response to an illicit proliferation and misuse of arms. I hope all these deliberations in the conventions might have been kept in mind by the government while bringing this bill. In that sense, broadly, I welcome the measures taken by the Ministry of Home Affairs. Coming to the Act, I would like to simply make two suggestions. Section 25 of this bill gives a new definition for the organized crime syndicate, in which any person can be involved in an offense. The sole intention of the bill is to punish those people who are indulging in an unlawful act which was meant for pecuniary benefits, gaining undue economic or other advantage. My humble submission to the Honorable Minister is that it should not be only advantages, because sometimes the crime is not committed only for pecuniary advantages. The crime can be committed on the basis of the principle of antagonism against a person or a group. When someone's philosophy, principle, or some policy does not suit the other person or a group of people, then a rivalry or a conflict occurs between them, and a crime will be committed by both of them. That is not addressed in the bill. I request the Honorable Minister that this point must be kept in mind. We are talking about the misuse of a weapon by an individual, but what about the misuse of a weapon by the armed forces? A person can be permitted to use a gun or a firearm for self-defense. What about the government-sponsored act by the armed forces or state police? 1 year ago, in Tamil Nadu, there was an agitation by the people against the Sterlite plant as it was creating pollution. It might be known to everybody. A huge group of people protested to close the Sterlite plant. People were sitting peacefully in front of the collectorate, but the state police fired at the people without following the norms prescribed under law. They aimed at particular persons who carried out the agitation for years together, those who were the leaders and who were the front runners in the agitation. The police fired at them using the telescope. It is absolutely a brutal murder committed on the part of the state government. The Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu did not offer any condolences. He did not even admit either on the floor of the house or outside that there was a shooting at all. He simply said that 13 persons were killed. So, this type of excess of power which is used by the state's armed forces must be regulated. Some provisions must also be brought into account. Currently in India, there are approximately 4 million arms licenses. It is being observed that possession of illegal firearms that are used to commit crime has increased, and therefore the Arms Act 1959 is being amended to regulate the acquisition, possession, sale, use, manufacture, transport, export and import of arms. This will ensure reduction in violence and will remove the use of illegal weapons in the society. Still, there is an issue of firearms that have been in the family for generations. Most of these weapons are old and obsolete. The inherited weapons are treasured items for such families and they are not for any use. Recently, the government has amended the arms rules to allow private manufacturers to produce firearms. Now, the government wants to restrict the ownership to one weapon. In such a case, the market of firearms will get affected since the citizens will be allowed the ownership of only one weapon. According to the National Crime Records Bureau, licensed firearms hardly contribute to the growing crime in the country. The proposed law will not only decrease the number of licensed firearms that a person can keep in possession, but will also increase the penalty for certain offenses under the Act. I am of the view that a person can obtain firearm license for only one weapon instead of three. In cases where a person has more than one firearm, after the commencement of the proposed Act, he has to deposit the remaining firearms within 1 year. Failure to do so will lead to cancellation of the license within 90 days from the date of expiry of 1 year. The validity of the license has been increased from 3 years to 5 years. The Act bans the manufacturing, sale, use, testing, transfer, and conversion of firearms without a license. The punishment for manufacturing, sale, transfer, conversion, repair and testing of firearms without a license is imprisonment for a minimum term of 7 years, which may extend to life imprisonment. The previous prescribed punishment was imprisonment for a minimum term of 3 years, which may extend to 7 years. Punishment for acquiring or possessing a prohibited arms or ammunition is imprisonment for a minimum term of 7 years, which may extend to 14 years. Previous prescribed punishment was imprisonment for a minimum term of 5 years, which may extend to 7 years. The proposed bill has inserted a new clause with respect to organized crime syndicate. The possession, manufacture, sale and transport of firearms by a member of syndicate will lead to imprisonment for 10 years, extendable up to life imprisonment along with a fine. Lastly, the introduction of this proposed bill shows a positive intent on the part of the government to reduce the use of illegal firearms, which leads to violence. I am very much happy that the shooters, who are the pride for the entire country, are allowed to keep three main arms, like rifles, shotguns, and handguns. It is a good thing for the shooters who are bringing laurels to the country. The advancement in technologies has made matters more gruesome, as firepower of illegal firearms can now be made at par with legal ones. The sophistication of weapons is also such that it becomes more difficult to identify illegal weapons. Law enforcement agencies have a tough time in identifying and establishing the illegality of weapons. Due to rise of firepower, illegal weapons will cause much more harm than before and will be a serious cause for concern in our internal security considerations. Illegal weapons are not only manufactured and traded within India, but also outside the country. Transport and smuggling of such illegal weapons is a vital link in creating a spike in the supply of such weapons. Such trade occurs across the entire border of India, which is an offshoot of the global nexus of illegal weapons trade. As the geopolitical scenario further deteriorates in our neighborhood and across the globe, it becomes pertinent to nip this supply chain through stronger legislation that can curb the demand to begin with. There are some suggestions from my side. I would request the Honorable Minister to incorporate the following suggestions. Whoever threatens any person at the point of arms to commit any other offense shall be punished with either imprisonment of 2 years or with a fine up to Rs. 20,000 or both. Secondly, every offense under this Act shall be cognizable and non-cognizable within the meaning of the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973. The third suggestion is the deletion of Section 39. The existing Section 39 may be deleted as it calls for unnecessary delay and technical problems. Before concluding, I would like to remind this august house that before becoming a member of this house, I was in the Andhra Pradesh State Police Department, and I fully understand the intent of the government in bringing this bill.